Warm greetings, Lana. Myself, Dr. S. Senthilrani, Associate Professor of Department of Electrical and Electronics Engineering of Velamal College of Engineering and Technology in Madurai, will be presenting a short lecture on the topic IC fabrication. Integrated circuit. As a name, it contains a complicated circuit inbuilt into a single chip. It is a miniaturized circuit which is of low pass, and it contains both active and passive elements put together. So put together, I mean that it can be fabricated together over a single crystalline silicon. So silicon, it is the base material to hold these active and passive components together. Integrated circuit can be classified based on the number of components or number of transistors or number of gates that can be accommodated into it. So based on this, the classification can be made into four different categories, namely small scale integration, medium scale integration, large scale integration, very large scale integration. And this classification, it is based on the number of transistors or number of logic gates that can be accommodated into a single chip. So here this tabulation, it explains the range of transistors that can be accommodated into an integrated circuit. So the generation, it was started with SSI, small scale integration, during the year 1964, then MSI, medium scale integration, during the year 1968, large scale integration, LSI, during the year 1971, very large scale integration, VLSI, during the year 1980, ULSI, ultra large scale integration, during the year 1984. So it started with some 1 to 10, and now it is here. You can find that the complexity of the circuits that are inbuilt into the integrated circuit, it has grown to a larger extent. The advantages of integrated circuit, as in the definition it was mentioned, it is a miniaturized circuit with low cost. So these are the basic advantages of the integrated circuit. So miniaturized circuit, which is of low cost, and this low cost, it is due to the bulk processing or batch processing that is done in the IC fabrication. And here more functionalities can be embedded into a single chip. So improved functional performance can be obtained, and here the operating speed, it is very high with a minimum power consumption. So these are the few advantages of integrated circuit. Next we pass on to the basic steps that are involved in fabricating a monolithic IC. Where mono, it means that single, lithic, it means that lithol, it is a Greek word which means that crystal. So over a single crystal, an integrated circuit can be fabricated. So that's why this IC, it is called as monolithic IC. And these 9 steps are the basic steps that are involved in fabricating an integrated circuit. It starts with the very first step called the silicon wafer preparation, where wafer, it can also be referred as substrate. Followed by that substrate growth, an epitaxial growth has to be done, then an oxide layer, it is being done, and after this oxide layer, the circuit, it will be imprinted over the integrated circuit by a process called as photolithographic process. Then to give the characterization for the circuit, diffusion ion implantation, it will be done. Since more number of circuits are being put together inside a single crystal, an isolation it is required, which will be done by a process called as isolation technique. There are different types of isolation techniques that can be used. Then at last, to join all the circuit, a process called metallization it is being done. And these are the steps that are put together into a single package through a process called as packaging. The first step called silicon wafer preparation or substrate preparation, further it contains 5 different steps which starts from the crystal growth and doping. So here the base material, it is the sand. So that sand, it is nothing but the crystal, it will be crushed and it will be put into a crucible, that it will be melted and it will be drawn into an ingot, and this ingot, it will be sliced into wafers, and all these will be polished to a higher degree, and etching it is being done, and finally cleaning it will be done. So this wafer preparation, it takes place by a process called as Chakralsky technique. And this process, it is the Chakralsky technique process, where it takes place in a closed chamber. You can find that this is the area where the vapor preparation, it will start. And these are the ingots. So it will be crushed, the crushed this crystal, polycrystalline material, it will be grown into a single crystalline ingot. So here polycrystalline structure, it is being converted into a single crystalline structure. And this is how the Chakralsky technique, it will be done. Here you can find that a crucible-like structure. So into this crucible, the crushed silicon polycrystalline material, it will be dropped into it. It will be melted to a higher degree of temperature, where the solid, it will be converted into a molten form. And a seed crystal, it will be dropped from this area. This seed crystal, it will be gradually inserted into this molten liquid and it will be rotated back. So here, downward movement, that it gets immersed into this molten form and then it will be pulled out. So due to that backward movement, here this seed crystal, it takes away the molten silicon along with it. So this molten silicon, you can find in this picture. So this picture, it will show, it will give a clear view. This is the initial material. So here the crushed silicon, it is being put inside the quartz crucible. It will be melted. You can find that a molten form, it is being found. So the insertion of the polycrystalline, the insertion of the ingot, you can find. So when you dip and when you lift it out, you can find that some of the molten liquid, it is being carried along with this single, along with this seed crystal. So this pulling method, it is called a crystal pulling technique, where the molten content, it is being taken along with the seed crystal. So this is how the outcome of that crystal pulling technique, it will be. You can find that an uneven shape of crystal, it is being formed, and this, it is a single crystalline material. So polycrystalline, it is being converted into a single crystalline material. And the above mentioned slide, you can find that you had an uneven surface. That uneven surface can be polished and it can be sliced into thin circular disc, which is called as wafer. And this wafer, it is polished to a higher degree. And you can find that it is a circular disc, and this circular disc, it will be cut with an industry diamond blade into a rectangular pieces. So here all these rectangular structure are nothing but the wafer or the integrated circuit. So here only the batch processing, it starts. And this is a view of a microchip. So this is one single integrated circuit into which a complicated circuit, it can be embedded. And after the slicing, it will be staked in a case. So that picture I have shown here. And this is all about the vapor preparation technique. So that vapor preparation, it is nothing but the base material of an integrated circuit. So this, it can be correlated to a process of preparing a cake. So when you prepare a cake, the initial thing that you will do, it is after preparing the batter, you will find for a cardboard or a wooden board. Over the wooden board, you will be doing different layerings, and that different layerings, it can be correlated with this integrated circuit fabrication. So the role of that cardboard or the wood in the cake preparation, it is to give the strength to the above laid layers. Very similarly, in the integrated circuit, the wafer preparation or the substrate preparation, it provides a mechanical strength to the above laid layers. So as I mentioned in the very beginning, nearly 9 steps it will be carried out to prepare an integrated circuit. So for preparing all those steps, a layer by layer processing, it will be done, and that layer, it is being laid over this vapor. So that's why we say that the vapor or the substrate, it should have the capability to hold the above laid layers over it. So that's why we conclude that the mechanical stability or the strength of the wafer or the substrate, it should be good. And the second step in the integrated circuit preparation, it is the epitaxial growth. where epitaxial growth, it is nothing but a thin layer of silicon. It will be overlaid over the silicon substrate. It is also referred as epigrowth. So all these, it is being accompanied by a chemical reaction. So you can find that SiCl4 along with the 2H2 with a degree of 1000, with a temperature of 1200 degrees Celsius, it gives a thin silicon layer along with the byproduct. So here we are concentrating over this, the thin silicon layer, and all these things, it takes place in a closed chamber. And this epitaxial, it is, as I mentioned, that a thin layer or a film-like material will be grown over the single crystalline film that was fabricated in the earlier step. And there are two different types of epitaxial growth. One, it is called as homoepitaxy. Another one, it is called as heteroepitaxy. Where homoepitaxy, it means that the substrate layer and the overlaid layers, they are going to be of same material. Whereas in heteroepitaxy, you will have different types of material that can be overlaid above each other. So this is the basic difference between homo and hetero. So homo, it means that same or single. Hetero, it means that different. So epi, it is a thin layer which is grown over the vapor. And this epitaxial growth, it is done with a process called as liquid phase epitaxial growth apparatus. And this one, it is a closed chamber, and inside the closed chamber, with a temperature of 1200 degrees Celsius, the silicon layer, it will be grown over the vapor. And this is how the arrangement it will be. You can find that you are having a closed chamber. This closed chamber, it is called as reaction chamber. And this reaction chamber, it contains a quartz tube, and inside this quartz tube, this circular structure are nothing but the silicon wafers. They are being placed, and this tray, it is called as a rack or a tray or a wafer holder. So this wafer holder, it will be inside this quartz tube, and this, it will be placed inside the closed chamber, that is the reaction chamber. Along with the assistance of this chemical reaction, a thin layer of silicon, it will be grown over this wafer. The other technique in which the epi layer can be grown, it is called as molecular beam epitaxy. In short, it is referred as MBE, and it is very similar to the previous step. So altogether, we can say that an epitaxial growth, it is nothing but a thin layer of silicon that is being grown over the wafer structure. So over this epitaxial layer only, we will be fabricating the integrated circuit. The third step in the IC fabrication, it is called as an oxide growth. So here the oxide growth, it is done mainly to provide a protective covering or a coat, and this protection, it is done to have the wafer or to have the integrated circuit to be unaffected by the other materials that are being released as byproduct during the fabrication process. So in short, we can say that a contamination, it should be controlled in the integrated circuit fabrication. So to stop the contamination, a thin layer of oxide growth, it has been done. Or we can say that it acts as an insulator, it provides a protective cover. And this oxide growth, it is being assisted by the following equation, Si plus H2O, it gives SiO2 plus a byproduct that is being released, and we are in need of this SiO2, and this SiO2, it is nothing but the epi layer along with the this reaction, it will be converted into a thin layer of oxide, which is called as an oxide growth. And this oxide growth, it can be controlled by the timing. So the time oxide thickness, it is being given in this graph. As the time it exceeds the thickness of the oxide, it will be extended. The next step, fourth step, it is called as photolithographic process. This is a process where the device, it will be patterned, or the small circuit that we are going to fabricate inside the integrated circuit, it will be patterned and it will be inserted in this step called as photolithography. So you can divide this word as photolithography. So photo, it is nothing but a light. That light, it is being used to draw some structure or circuit inside the integrated circuit. And this photolithographic process, it is assisted by two different techniques. which is called as making a photo mask. Another one, it is called as photo etching. So this, it can be correlated with the process called as developing a negative of a photo film. So whatever we are doing in developing a photograph, the very similar process it is being done in a photolithographic process. So as I mentioned that it contains two process. One, it is called as creation of mask. Another one, it is called as etching. So this mask, it is nothing but it is the masterpiece in which the integrated circuit it will be made, and this artwork it will be used for developing the circuit over the integrated circuit. So when you develop the circuit, you will have some unwanted structure or component to be introduced during that process that has to be removed from the circuit. So that it is being done by a process called as photo etching. So altogether, photolithographic process, it is containing two steps called as photographic mask or mask preparation followed by the photo etching. So this is how the mask preparation it will be done. You will have a masterpiece. So this structure, you can find that some L-shaped structure is being given as a mask. So when you pass the light through this mask, you can find that the light, it will flow or it will move through this structure. So the movement of light, it creates a structure in the underneath piece. And here I have taken this as vapor. So through this region, when I pass the light through this vent or duct, this light, it will fall on the vapor and it creates the structure that is being found over the mask. Another detailed explanation about the photolithographic process, you can find that there is a substrate, then an epi layer, then you can find an oxide growth here, and it is being assisted with a light source. In this one, it is a photo mask, and here you can find vents are being provided. So when light it is allowed to fall, this light it will move through this vent and it will be projected via a lens and it will be given to the substrate. So this is how the pattern it is being created. So this photolithographic process, it can be done by using two different process. One, it is called as a positive photoresist. Another one, it is called as a negative photoresist. So both the process are very similar. At the very first step, what you will be doing? You will be doing a silicon substrate over which an epi layer and an oxide growth it will be done. And this it will be sent to the photolithographic stage, where a photoresist it will be laid. So this photoresist, it can be either a positive photoresist or it can be of a negative photoresist. And this photoresist, when it is having this photo masking process, you can find that through this vent, the light it is allowed to fall over the photoresist material. So depending upon the material, the development of the resist, it gets different here. That is the basic difference between positive and negative photoresist. So in this picture, you can find that the vent it is being provided, the both the side and at the center. So the light it moves at the either side and at the center to the photoresist. In case of positive photoresist material, the area under which the light falls over the photoresist, that alone it can be etched out. The remaining portion it becomes insoluble. Whereas in case of negative, the reverse case of positive photoresist, it will be found in negative. So here, the portion where you found the light exposure, that it will be held constant, and this region, it will be removed by the solution. So this is how the positive and negative photoresist developing, it gets deferred. And followed by that, you can go for either a dry etching or wet etching. Dry etching or wet etching, it is nothing but either you can use a gas or you can use a liquid to remove the unwanted content in the circuit. And finally, your circuit pattern will be in this way. So etching, it is nothing but unwanted content, it is being removed. So here the unwanted content, it is nothing but the resist material. So this region alone, it is required in our circuit. So that it is being done by the positive photoresist, and negative photoresist, this region it is being required. So you can find that these portions alone, it will be formed when you use a negative photoresist, and in positive, these regions are alone formed in case of positive photoresist. So to be simple, I can say that you are applying a resist material, and after applying the resist material, the mask it is being placed Through the mask, depending upon the vent creation, the light will be allowed to fall over the photoresist material. And depending upon the photoresist material, either the exposed or the unexposed portion, it can be removed. So this is how the photolithographic process will be done. And followed by the photolithographic process, the very important step in an integrated circuit, it is called as the diffusion. So this is the point at which the device characterization can be done. So here the introduction of impurities, it is being done by a process called as photo diffusion. Followed by photolithographic process, the circuit patterning, it will be assisted by a process called as diffusion, where impurities can be inserted. Another technique it is available to introduce an impurity, that is called as ion implantation. So in both the steps, ion implantation or diffusion, the impurities, it is being inserted or introduced intentionally. So here device characterization, it is being done either by using a diffusion process or ion implantation process. So this is the setup of an ion implantation system, where again it is being assisted inside a closed chamber. Here you can find that the acceleration electrodes are there, and here you can find some deflection plates with respect to y-axis and x-axis have been placed here. So here the ion beams have been deflected and it hits the target. So this one, it is the tray or it is the wafer holder. Over the wafer holder, the wafers, it will be arranged in state, and this, it will be allowed to move, and ion beams, it will hit the target. Hit the target, I mean that the wafer, it will be allowed to have contact with ion beams, where the device characterization, it will be done. And this target chamber, it is a closed chamber. And followed by this device characterization, the most important technique in an integrated circuit that you require, it is an isolation. The reason for requiring isolation here, it is you want to segregate different circuits from each other. So both electrical isolation and physical isolation has to be provided to an integrated circuit. There are two different types of isolation techniques that can be provided. One, it is called as PN isolation. Another one, it is called as dielectric isolation. So in both the isolation, the basic step, it is you want to provide electrical isolation and physical isolation. We'll start with the technique of PN isolation. So here you can find that these are the epitaxial layers that have been separated, and they are physically separated. So to have the electrical isolation, purposely we are introducing a P layer here, and this P layer along with this N layer, it forms a PN diode. So again here you can form that here it is a P layer and here it is an N layer. So this representation, it is being given as an N layer, a P layer and an N layer. So here you can find that two diodes are back to back connected. So when two diodes are back to back connected, you can find that there won't be any interconnection between this N epitaxial layer to this N epitaxial layer. So that's why it is called as PN isolation technique. So here, this is a commonly used isolation technique in an integrated circuit, whereas the basic disadvantage of this, it is the parasitic capacitance, it creates an undesired effect in this isolation technique. Whereas it is the most simple isolation technique, where you don't need any additional step to create this isolation, and it is also a low cost technique. The next one, it is the dielectric isolation technique. Dielectric isolation, as this word dielectric, it is here it is nothing but an SiO2. So here you are creating a protective cover for your integrated circuit. So here you can find that you assume that this EBC, it is a transistor emitter base collector. So this emitter base collector, you can find that it is being kept inside this red color box. So this red color box or surrounding, it is nothing but the silicon dioxide, and this silicon dioxide, it acts as a dielectric isolation, where this EBC, that is emitter base collector, it will not have any contact with the P substrate that is being given here. Whereas the disadvantage of this step, it is an additional fabrication step, it is required for fabricating this dielectric isolation. So to create this SiO2 layer, an additional fabrication step it is required. So you have to do a photolithographic process to insert this SiO2 layer. So that is a major disadvantage. Whereas in case of PN isolation, no additional fabrication step it is required. Whereas in this case, an additional fabrication step it is required. Here, the advantage it is, you can find both physical as well as electrical isolation it is being provided by this isolation technique. And when compared to PN isolation, this dielectric isolation, it is quite expensive. And it can be used for high-graded applications alone. For example, aerospace, military application, wherever you require a superior performance, in such cases, you can go for dielectric isolation. So, whatever I have explained that, the same thing I have shared in this. So, I'm going to skip this slide. The last before step, it is called as metallization. So, from the name itself, it is very clear that some metal layer it is to be introduced inside the integrated circuit. So the need for introducing a metal layer, it is nothing but an interconnection it is required for an integrated circuit. So here you are laying more number of circuits inside a single chip, and all those circuit it should be integrated with each other. So that's why we go for a step called as metallization. So the concept of metallization, it is to provide an interconnection inside the circuit. So metallization is a process of growing a thin layer of metal, which is basically done to create interconnection between the components on the chip as well as to take the connection outside the integrated circuit. So both for internal as well as for external communication, you require a process called as metallization. So here contact, interconnects and gates can be done with the a step called as metallization. And the requirement of metallization, it is a low resistive material it should be, and it should be easy to form. So these are the most important requirement for an metal layer growth in an integrated circuit. And here also a patterning it will be done, and this patterning it will be it will develop a metal layer, and that metal layer it is used to grow the interconnection between the integrated circuit. So this is the process where the metal layer it is to be grown. So here you can find that a closed reaction chamber. In this chamber it is called as a vacuum chamber, and inside the vacuum chamber you can find a source, and you can find a semicircular structure. The semicircular structure, it is having some races to be pointed out, where these races are nothing but here the wafers, it will be arranged here, and this source, it will be evaporated and it will be allowed to hit over this target, and this it will create the metal layer here. And the wafer preparation, the metal growth, it can be done with a process called as chemical vapor deposition, which is called as a CVD process. In CVD process, these are the two metals that can be deposited over the integrated circuit. So here the merits of CVD process, it is assisted with a low temperature, and here the interconnection that is being developed with the CVD process, it is good when compared to the rest of the process, and it gives a high throughput. Another step, it is called as physical vapor deposition, and this physical vapor deposition, it can be done with two different steps. One it is called as evaporation, another one it is called as splittering. In both the process, you have to condense the condensed solid will be converted into the gaseous state. So here you are having a solid, that solid it will be converted into a wafer phase, and in that wafer phase only this metal growth it is being done. And I'm not going to go in detail with this evaporation and splittering technique, because the simple thing that you have to remember, it is the solid metal content, it is being converted into a wafer. That wafer, it will be coated over the integrated circuit to provide the interconnection. The aluminium, it is preferred for the metallization process. The reason it is a good conductor, And this process, it is very easy in CVD process, chemical vapor deposition process. So that's why we prefer aluminium, and it gives a very good mechanical bond with the silicon, and it is having a low resistance content. So these are the advantages of preferring aluminium for metallization process. And here I have given a tabulation. This tabulation, it explains what are the different materials that can be used for this metallization and what are the different metal contacts that are used in an integrated circuit. So gate contacts and interconnection, top level connection, diffusion barrier, and selectively formed interconnection. And these are the different metals that can be used for growing the metal layer. So the last step in the integrated circuit fabrication, it is called as IC package. So IC packaging, it is nothing but the above done 8 step, it has to be put inside a package. That package, it is called as an integrated circuit package. In this package, it is of 3 different types. One, it is called as metal can package. Another one, it is called as dual inline package. The third one, it is called as ceramic flat package. So here it is nothing but you are encapsulating the integrated circuit or the silicon wafer. So here the silicon wafer, right from the beginning, we have insisted one single point that there should not be any contamination entry inside the integrated circuit. So here we are maintaining the purity level to a maximum extent. So here the integrated circuit, once it is fabricated, to ensure its reliability, to ensure its performance, it has to be packed in, or it has to be concealed properly. So that concealing process, it is called as packaging, or it is called as encapsulation. So here the wafer, it is being put inside the protective cover. That protective cover, it is called as IC package. So the final outcome, it is, this is what we'll be seeing, a black color chip with some metal leads projecting out. So here inside this black color case, you will find an integrated circuit that will have metal buds. That metal buds, it will be having contact with this external lead. So the leads in an integrated circuit, it can also be referred as IC legs. So this is how the structure of an IC package, it will be. You can find that this is the leg, that is the externally visible IC leg or lead. And this is the integrated circuit that was being fabricated by using the above mentioned 8 steps. To this, you will have a bud joining here. So here a bond wiring, it is being done. So that die, it will be attached here, and it will be placed in a lead frame pad. And over this lead frame pad, you will have a die. This die, it is nothing but the wafer. And here this yellow color mark, it is nothing but the interconnection that is provided between the integrated circuit or the wafer with the external world communication. And the cross-sectional view of the metal can package I have given here. This figure, it is the metal can package cross-sectional view, and this one, it is the flat package view. In both the cases, you can find that there are different layers that are being held together inside an integrated circuit.